I'll get you one. Take care.
Thank you so very much, Paul. And it's a real pleasure to be here this morning, not so cold day, and all of you here bright and early. Bright and early for this sort of overview on myeloma. And I'm going to start off with a very simple subject, but of a lot of practical importance. And so I'm going to talk about diagnosis of myeloma, which sounds like people who are in this room have already been diagnosed. So why do we even talk about diagnosis? The importance of that is that you do hear, as you see your doctors here, or back home, all different numbers. You hear about M spike and IgG and free light chain and bone marrow. And so I'm going to give you some overview of how to make sense out of those numbers. And most of the time, leave it to your doctors to make sense. But I do know that you do follow those numbers very closely, and rightly so. And so how do we understand, what do we do to diagnose? And more importantly, I'm going to give you some information about what are we doing new things that's going to change how we look at myeloma, how we treat myeloma, how some of the new drugs are going to come from, all the different genomic studies that we are doing together. So myeloma is changing. Changing in the sense that when I started doing treatment for myeloma around 25 years ago, patients, when they come for treatment, there are very many complications from the disease. They were diagnosed late, and they would, almost 90% of the patient would have some symptoms, bone pain, kidney problem, anemia, and other. Now we see myeloma at a much earlier stages. We see only 60% patients have some symptoms. There are 30-40% patients who come because they went to their primary care on a routine exam and they were diagnosed with some symptoms. They go for insurance workup and find there's a protein somewhere in urine and they are worked up and found to be myeloma. So we do find patients coming up earlier on. And what that does is, in a way, is that they have less symptoms, they're feeling better, and as the treatments are working so very well, they have a normal quality of life for a long period of time. And that's very important in how we manage this disease. In fact, patients used to have, one-third of patients used to have kidney problems in the old days. Now, a very small number have starting out significant kidney problem. We don't see many patients now on dialysis when we see. In old days, we would have kidney doctors send patients to us because they diagnosed myeloma. So the characteristic is changing. Now, when we diagnose myeloma, there are three things we do. We do blood test, we do bone marrow, and we look at the X-ray for bone lesions. And that's how we sort of in a simple way diagnose myeloma. And what's important for us to know and talk about is that there are many more things we do today. We still do this, and I'll go through that a little bit to explain. But we do a lot of new tests and more modern tests. And so we do what is called free light chain. We do FISH analysis, which you all of you know well. We do quite frequently MRI and PET scans. And then on a research side, we do all different genomic studies. If we don't use yet to treat our patients, but we are right there to consider the next step of using some of these genomic studies to treat the patient. And I'll show an example how this is going to be happening literally as we speak to change the treatment. So when you go to the oncologist first, there are blood tests done and urine tests done. And I'll explain to you what numbers you look at. And the most important number that we look at and that a lot of you would follow is called M spike. It's done through the protein electrophoresis, and everybody talks about M spike. Now, for practical purpose, M spike stands for myeloma spike. On the medical side, it's called monoclonal spike, but I think M for myeloma is quite appropriate there. Now, this is the number that we try to bring it down as much as possible. If it gets there, and we are successful almost in 50 to 60% of the patient now, to get it to zero. And that's our goal. That's the number we want to bring it down, up to zero if we can. And it can go up to 5, and they're all different numbers. but coming to zero is the thing. So that's the first thing we look at, M spike, and this actually, this peak is the M spike. That's what we measure. Then we do a test called immunofixation, and that tells us what type of this myeloma protein is. And so you will hear words like IgG kappa or IgA lambda and something like that, IgG, IgA, kappa, lambda, combination of it. And that's the type of myeloma. So when you see a doctor's note, it will say that such and such person has IgG kappa multiple myeloma. And that's how we find out this particular patient has IgG and kappa. And we do it in the beginning to find out what type it is, and in the later part after treatment, we sometimes repeat it to see is that protein disappeared, and that's an important test, you know, for immunofixation. And then the third protein we measure is actually the immunoglobulin itself. So you will hear my IgG level is X and my IgA level is Y, depending upon the type of myeloma. This is not the number that should go to zero. It can never and it will not go to zero, because we all have normal immunoglobulins that we need to fight infection. And so this number, we bring it down in the normal range. And once it's in normal range, we are happy with it. So that's the blood test we do. The second test is this 24-hour Bang-Jones protein. And I think contrary to what one would guess, patients complain more about 24-hour urine than bone marrow. Do I have to bring it? And our task has actually become even more difficult that, you know, a lot of patients come from out of town, sometimes out of country, and now it's quite difficult to bring a jug of urine in the plane. Wasn't the case before, but now with the security, it's difficult. Still, this is an important test, so one way or another, we quite often get it done. Normally, there should not be any Bang-Jones protein in urine, so that's another number we want to bring it to zero. Now, this is not the test we do every time, fortunately, because if you do not have protein in urine from the beginning, we don't need to do it multiple times. We still repeat periodically, but not at every visit. But if your myeloma is only seen in urine and not in blood, then we do it every time, because that's what we follow to see if your treatment is working. And then we have this new test, which is not so new. It's been there for now 8-9 years, called serum free light chain. And I'll tell you a little bit more about it, because we do it quite frequently now in every patient, almost every time point. But these are the urine and blood tests that you will undergo almost routinely to follow your myeloma for diagnosis, for follow-up, and then subsequently on a later treatment. The second is the bone marrow, which we do it in the beginning for diagnosis and less frequently subsequently. We look for these blue-looking cells. These are the bad guys. That's the enemy, the myeloma cells, and that's what we want to kill. And then we do some fancy tests to identify, is this myeloma making the same protein? And that's how we connect the two. The bone marrow, as I said, is needed at diagnosis, but not frequently in between, because all the blood tests and urine tests will tell me what's my treatment doing. At some point, when we know that this number has gone to zero, then we do bone marrow to see, is there anything in the bone marrow or it's clean? And if there is a suspicion that now the myeloma is coming back, we may repeat bone marrow to see if it is the numbers are increasing. But that's the early part of the stress and the later part when we do the bone marrow. Very rarely patients do not make the protein, and that's when we may do bone marrow slightly more frequently. Again, not every month, fortunately. So these are the two things we need to see if patient has myeloma-like disease. But for diagnosis of an active myeloma where we start the treatment, we need something else. We need these bad guys to have caused damage in the body, some effect on the body. And in that regards, we do blood test to see if you have anemia. We do chemistry to see if you have high calcium or is your kidney not functioning well. And then we do some imaging studies, skeletal survey or something else that I will show you, that will tell me if there are bone lesions. And basically, this test drives the diagnosis of the disease. So if you have protein and the bone marrow involvement, but nothing else, there's no effect on the body, that's not myeloma that needs treatment. That's an early stage of disease where we call it smoldering myeloma or MGUS. And in general, outside of research, we don't advocate treatment for this disease at the moment. But if any of these things have happened, any one, then it's called active myeloma, and that's when you start regular treatment, transplant if needed, and everything else. This early diagnosis you will hear a little bit later about. That's a condition which has this myeloma-like cells there in the bone marrow, but in low number. Less than 10% for MGUS, could be higher in smoldering myeloma. The protein is also not too high, but it could be high in smoldering myeloma, but it has not caused any effect. And the reason we don't treat is because in significant number of patients, so 70% of the patient with MGUS, almost in their lifetime, are not going to have anything else happen from that. They're not going to get myeloma, 70%. So patients with MGUS, we really don't do anything. In smoldering myeloma, the proportion of patients who may get myeloma is higher, but it's not 100%. Even in what we call high-risk smoldering myeloma, 20% patient will not have myeloma develop over 10 or more years. So automatically, I cannot expose you to medicines which is not going to make a difference. And unlike many diseases like breast cancer, lung cancer, colon cancer, where getting rid of the disease early is so important because it otherwise will spread, in myeloma, that urgency is not really there, that I do have to control it. So in smoldering myeloma, we wait for years, and we all have patients for 10, 15 plus years having done nothing. We just meet every 6 months, talk about weather, and till 6 months later. And in Boston, there is a lot to talk about. So, but that's the good news. Except our lot of research and some of the genomic research that I do and as a group we do is beginning to tell us, can we find those smoldering patients or even those MGUS patients who may develop myeloma, has higher chance of developing myeloma? Then that's a group that I would probably focus on and try and see if we can prevent it. And we are beginning to develop some methods, some treatments that hopefully can successfully prevent smoldering myeloma from ever becoming myeloma. And that's really sort of preventive measure. So we have an ongoing study, for example, with a vaccine that we give it like tetanus vaccine, but it's a vaccine against myeloma. And if successful, we can use the same vaccine for myeloma also. So that's one example of many other approaches we are developing to see that the smoldering myeloma that has higher chance of becoming myeloma, can we just stop that? But otherwise, outside of this research, patients with smoldering myeloma, we follow. And I know, and I don't know, is anybody in this audience has smoldering disease? Some has. And I know it's very frustrating that you would think I have a time bomb ticking here and you just said do nothing, right? But that's for right reason. And another right reason is that the treatment I would have given 5 years ago versus treatment I give today is quite different and better, more effective. So because there is no need to do it early, and because if you may not need it, we don't do anything. If you need it, and when you need it, we will be doing something better, with better drugs, with easier drugs, less toxic drugs, with better outcome. And so despite the discomfort, I think over time, patients do know that this is the right thing to do, and we move on. So this is how we make the diagnosis of myeloma. Now, the test that has become available and quite routinely used is this light chain assay. And I just remember the name because you will hear it from time to time. Oh, your light chain is up or light chain is down. And what this test has done for us is that originally the purpose was that this test will get rid of the need for doing the urine, 24-hour urine thing. It's not happened. We still do both. But because of this test, in old days, there were a number of patients, almost 20 to 30% of the patients, but they didn't have measurable protein. So we have to do more x-rays, we have to do more bone marrows because it was called non-secretory myeloma. Now with this test, we are able to measure protein in most of the patient, 95% of the patient. So a very small number of patients have non-secretory disease. It's much easier to follow these patients. And so this has become a very important test. It's also an important test because we are beginning to understand that if this test is abnormal, then we can identify some of those patients who may have a higher risk of developing myeloma from smoldering myeloma or from MGUS. And that's a group that we can do some research on to consider preventative measures if we want to look for that. So it is helping us identify those higher risk patients. And so we now use this test routinely at every stage. You get it at diagnosis, you get it even in smoldering disease, and for response evaluation, for looking at progression, and looking at prognosis. So it has become a very standard test that we do all throughout. And for imaging, you will get lots of x-rays to look for bone lesions. And it's we have been doing this for last, this x-rays, we've been doing this for last 30, 40 years, and that is still the standard test, how we diagnose myeloma. What has changed is that we are beginning to use some of the newer tests more frequently. You would get MRIs more frequently, you get PET CT scan frequently, and they provide information that plain x-rays are not able to do it. And we are beginning to think whether when we look for bone lesions for diagnosis of myeloma, instead of doing just x-rays, we may want to do this newer imaging, more sensitive imaging. So, for example, in the MRI, this is normal MRI. This dark area of the bone is what normal it should be. In myeloma, because bone marrow is filled with myeloma cell, on MRI it looks white. You can see the difference. And that's diagnosis myeloma. Sometimes you see these lesions here. It should be uniform, but there are lumps and bumps here. And that's what we follow. On PET scan, one of the patients yesterday described that I had light bulbs all over, and that's how it looks like. You would see these dots on PET scan, and that's these dots represent myeloma. You can see lots of dots, and the patient described that some lights go off and some lights come up, and that's how we judge. So after treatment, this is what happened. All the light bulbs are gone, and then we know that this patient has responded. So there are situations where we use this to really judge that the treatment has succeeded. See, all the dots are gone. Some dots are there, but they are normal. That's a normal organ function. So those dots should not go, but the others are. And this is how we can use PET CT scan. Now, that doesn't mean everybody in this room needs to get a PET CT scan, so I don't want you to call Paul tomorrow and say, get my PET CT, because not everybody needs it. And again, if you don't need it, you don't want to be exposed to procedures, radiation, and other thing. Most of the time, the blood test is good enough to measure the disease and the response to the treatment. But when we need it, we are doing this. We are also trying to do it in certain newer setting where we can judge the response of the treatment better. So these are the things we do for diagnosis of myeloma, and I'm sure most of you have gone through some of these or do know some of these tests being done. The second part is about prognostication and see what type of myeloma one has. And this is primarily, you would think that prognostication is for treatment purpose, and not really so. And the reason we yet do not use prognostic factor for treatment is because every myeloma patient gets the best treatment. So we don't have to give less treatment because your myeloma is not what one would call bad myeloma. We are treating everybody equally. It's only certain stages, late stages, is where if myeloma is more aggressive, we may want to become more aggressive with our treatment. Consider allogeneic transplant, and you may hear about a little bit about it, which is not routinely done. It's a high-risk procedure, but the myeloma has to be high risk for us to take the risk of treating with difficult treatment. But over time, this may change, and you will see how this is making things better. But this prognosis, prognostication gives us ability to not really predict, but at least plan how we are going to manage the disease, whether we give something more beginning, something less in the beginning. We can give you some more ideas about what you should do if you want to take a trip to Bahamas, whether you should go or wait. And it really sometimes helps individualize. Most of all, it helps us research. It helps us find new targets, new drugs, and some of the talks you will hear, Dr. Anderson is going to talk about new drugs and targets, and it comes from some of this research, looking at the prognosis. So the way we judge, some of them are very simple tests. We do simple blood test, and we can come up with this ISS staging system. We do bone marrow and do what is now more frequently done called FISH analysis, and that's helpful. And then there are some other features, especially this extramedullary disease, which we detect with PET scan. And when suspected, we do PET scan to look at extramedullary disease. And very importantly, this is becoming one of the most important areas of research to use all different fancy genomic studies to sequence the whole genome of myeloma and understand what's happening. But this international staging system has been one of the standard. Now, what has happened in international staging system is that it was developed a while ago. We have new drugs come in, and this ISS staging system is not so critical anymore. And so it is done, but not utilized a whole lot. But FISH analysis is still important. And what we do in FISH analysis is all these fancy studies on your myeloma cells. We do bone marrow, take your myeloma cells and do the study. And you would see two dots which are separated. When the two dots are come together like this, this union is bad. That's a bad marriage. There are two chromosomes which have come together, they shouldn't. And that's where we call 414 translocation, like here, or this is called 1416 translocation and others. So that's how we identify. Or if one of the dot is gone, then we know a chromosome is missing. So for example, here, there's one of the green dot is gone, and that's not good. That's a 17, chromosome 17 missing. Or here, these two are missing from here. So two red dots, two green dots, here one red dot is missing. Here both of this, one pair of the dots are missing. And so basically we look at which chromosome is gone. So you would hear 17p deletion or chromosome 13 deletion. That's what this represents. And that tells us how your myeloma cell may behave a little bit. But more importantly, where we are going from all this now is that some of these studies also tell us what are the targets in your myeloma that we should go after. So for example, the 414 translocation that you would hear, this green color represents a protein called FGFR3, which is making your myeloma cell behave the way it does. And now we have drugs that can target this. Similarly, there's another target like cyclin D1. And you will hear a lot, I would reserve this for the next talk, where you will hear a lot about not just this, but other similar target that are identified that we can go after. And there are lots of different chromosomal changes that you will hear. So when you try to read your report, and how many of you try to read your report routinely? I think almost all of you. And you will see all this different. The important thing to remember is that these chromosomal changes are also changing. For example, chromosome 13 used to be a bad chromosome. So I have chromosome 13 myeloma. That's a really bad disease. Not so anymore. It used to be there around in early 90s when we were doing only transplant. We didn't have any new drugs. Chromosome 13 abnormality was a bad news. Now it is not. And we almost do not even do it, because there's no consequence of having it or not having it. The new drugs have overcome those kind of problems. So this type of chromosomal change, genetic change, that are not so good, keeps on changing. And just because of what advances we have made in the treatment, because treatment can overcome. So to give an example, bortezomib. Now, this type of curves you might see often today, they are complicated. I don't want or expect you to really follow it closely. But all it means is that when the graph keeps on going down, it means patients are relapsing. So we don't want it to go down. We want it to stay as up as possible. Now, these two curves would be separated like this very widely. When they're closer, that means the patients are doing very similar. So here, the red one is where patients had this chromosomal change, and green is they did not. And the curves are quite close together. That means that the drug is not you're not able to differentiate those with chromosomal change and those without chromosomal change, because they do both very well. The drug is able to overcome that effect. And similarly, this curve is light overlapping with or without chromosomal change. So lenalidomide is able to overcome the bad effect of the chromosome. So now 414 is becoming less important. Everybody gets lenalidomide. I'm sure you all have. And so whether you have it or not, it doesn't matter, that you're going to do well. And so this is how things are changing. So one of the questions that I do get asked, and because they have not been told, is what is my stage? What stage is my myeloma? And the reason quite often you are not told is because this ISS and other staging system doesn't matter as much. So if you have stage 3 disease, you're still going to do well. So stage 3 disease gives you an impression that it's a bad myeloma, it's an aggressive advanced myeloma. It's true for breast or lung or colon cancer. You have stage 1 lung cancer, you get surgery done, that's over. You have stage 4 disease, lung cancer, it's spread around, that's not a good thing, we can't treat well. That's where it matters, so you need to know. In myeloma, the staging is not so critical, so quite often we would forget to tell you. So we can still stage it by using the criteria as I showed, but because it has no real significant consequence, how well you do, we do not necessarily focus on it. So if you don't hear about it, you can still ask, but you don't need to worry what stage you end up being, because that's more theoretical. So now we are still developing or planning to develop strategies to understand if we need to treat patients with different risk, with different treatment. Right now, IVD combination works the best, and we'll have a fourth drug hopefully added soon to make it a four-drug combination, which works even better. But it's applied uniformly to different stages of the disease. So because you have 17p deletion, we do make minor changes. For example, 17p deletion patient, we consider a little bit different maintenance strategy, for example. But that's a very relative thing. The beginning remains the same. Now, what we are trying to focus on in the last few minutes I'll talk about is what are we doing to understand myeloma even better? And that's where some of these newer technologies come up. I mean, these are all scientific terminologies. What basically it tells is that we can really go into your myeloma genome and look at every gene, what it is doing. So, for example, there are 33,000 genes in our cell, 33,000. And it's, that makes the whole genome complex. To give you a perspective, you know, we all know about the Ebola epidemic, right? In Ebola virus, there are 7 genes. The virus is doing everything it does with 7 genes. In human body, there are 33,000 genes, so you know how complex it is. But we can now know exactly where each gene is and what is it doing to myeloma cells. And that's the big advance in the last few years. Using that information, we can now do different categorization. So for example, the red means the gene is up, the green means the gene is down, and we can divide the patient into 3 different groups. Patients who are in this group have a longer effect of the treatment, they don't relapse as quickly. Patients who are here in red, they relapse a little bit more quicker or earlier. So these are the patients. When we identify them, we may want to give longer treatment, higher treatment, a little bit different combination, et cetera. But we are beginning to know that. The other thing we have realized, and this is really new studies from 2014, where we did a study in around 100 patients and looked at the whole genome. And you would read about this in all different media, from New York Times to Wall Street Journal to USA Today, about doing genome sequencing. And so this is what we did in myeloma. And we were able to do it with your help, your support, and very importantly, your bone marrow. But we can identify all different single mutations. Sometimes there are 1 in 1,000,000 and sometimes there are 1 in 1,000,000,000. But we identify that in a myeloma patient, we find 50 different mutations. There's no single mutation which is driving the whole disease, so that's why it is so complex. There's no one target. It's a multi-target thing. So that's why we use drugs which are multi-target. But we now are beginning to know. And what is going to become reasonably routine at our place is that when you come in, especially as a new patient, but sometimes a follow-up patient, is that we will do this kind of analysis on your myeloma cells, and we are going to identify what mutations your myeloma has. And that may help us in future about even selecting the drug, as I will show you in a minute. The second important thing we have learned is that myeloma cells keep on changing. It changes its color. And that's true for not only myeloma, for all cancer. So when you diagnose myeloma in the beginning, it has certain mutational changes and it has certain color and characteristic. when it comes back, and it comes back now much later, 8, 9, 10 years later. But if it does come back, it has a little different characteristics. It has acquired some new abilities and new change that is now able to resist the treatment that we gave in the beginning. So it's kind of unfortunately a smart cell. We just had to be smarter. So we now know what change has come up, and then we can beat it. And our main focus of the research now is that can we stop myeloma from being smart? Can we stop it from being able to change? Because if we stop it from changing, it's not going to be able to overcome the treatment we are giving, and we can kill better. So one of the very great focus of my research has been to look at methods to stop it from changing. Let it not change the color. So for example, here at the diagnosis, myeloma was like this, a straight line. When it comes back, it has become zigzaggy. It has gotten new changes to maybe resist bortezomib, maybe resist lenalidomide, or other treatment or transplant. And we want to keep the straight line straight, and we are making very good progress in that direction. So how does this finding mutations help? So one of the mutation that is in myeloma we find is called BRAF mutation, that one gene has one little change that makes it behave differently. And this red color represents this mutated gene. Now, this type of change is observed very frequently in melanoma. Now, melanoma and myeloma have nothing in common. Melanoma is the skin cancer that one can get. But that cancer has this change, and there's a drug that now doctors use, you know, treating melanoma uses, and it's effective in melanoma. So in myeloma, we thought one could try because it's the same mutation. And so one of our colleagues who trained with us here, he's now in Germany, he gave this particular patient that particular melanoma drug that goes after this one mutation. And what he observed and he published recently is that after one cycle, myeloma came down. And it stayed down. It didn't stay down forever, but for a certain period. And the myeloma lesion had also become smaller. So protein came down, lesion became smaller, and this dark red became lighter red, so the mutation wasn't functioning as well. And so with that, now we can think about this kind of treatments using the mutational profile. So we are beginning to do mutational profile in these patients very routinely. And the last couple things I would say is that we measure response. Right? We say you are in complete remission, partial remission, and we are developing methods to see can we even measure responses further. When we say you are in CR and we don't see myeloma in your body, till yesterday it meant we cannot see it, it's still there because it comes back. We can only look for one cell in 100, but not beyond. So now we are developing methods that we can detect one cell in 1,000,000, and so then we can really define it better. And we are now beginning to almost do this kind of testing almost routinely. We can take your bone marrow when required or when indicated and do this. And patients whose myeloma has really disappeared with this very sensitive test, what we call MRD testing, they do much better than those who still has MRD positive. They're all in CR or complete remission, but the tests suggest that. So this is the next direction of how we would also follow your myeloma. And we believe that once we get MRD negativity, that would be sort of the last step before we can say we are able to cure patients. So we are almost right there with all the different things we do. And so to summarize, what we are hoping to do in the end is, and what we had in this patient, is that we can look at your myeloma cell for all different mutations. The letters in red are the abnormal genes in this particular patient. And for that patient, for each of these abnormal genes, we have drugs that are outside here. And these are the drugs we would use for the patient, and that they were likely to be effective, and not use the drugs which are not going to be effective. And that's where we avoid toxicity and have more effective treatment. So we are almost there, and this work was actually done quite a few years ago, but this is becoming more of a reality today than what it was around 10 years ago. So I think I would stop there and see if you have any questions. Thank you very much.